Hello everyone, my name is Niharika. I'm a fifth year PhD student at the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Johns Hopkins University. So today I will present our recent work in deep learning for connectomics. So specifically, we have designed a graph neural network to combine multimodal information from resting state fMRI and DTI connectomes to predict behavioral measures. Keeping this in mind, here's a brief outline of my talk. I will first describe some background on the problem that we are trying to address. So recently, there has been an increasing interest in connectomic studies of the human brain. For example, mapping out the communication patterns between the regions of the brain and understanding how these affect our behavior and health. So in this work, we analyze two complementary views of brain connectivity. One of them is functional connectivity, which measures blood flow patterns in a resting state. So at rest, we expect that blood flow responses between regions of the brain that communicate with each other display synchrony in their responses. So this synchrony is captured by the functional connectome, for example, a correlation matrix between the ROI time series. On the other hand, diffusion tensor imaging is a structural imaging modality which uses the diffusion of water molecules in the brain as a proxy for the presence of an anatomical relationship between two connected regions. These DTI tensors are sampled across gradient directions to obtain a point-wise diffusion model, which we use to construct a detailed structural connectivity graph for each patient via tryptography. Overall, both of these modalities provide complementary pictures of brain connectivity. So a natural direction to explore would be to how to fuse information from these viewpoints together. Keeping this in mind, here's a typical multimodal integration pipeline which uses data-driven feature extraction to perhaps relate to diagnosis or clinical severity. And there are two main categories that these methods fall into. Some of these techniques separately analyze the statistics or features from the modalities and then draw correspondences between them post hoc. Another common approach is to combine these modalities using data-driven techniques in the same feature extraction modules, and then a discriminative model is trained on these features. Our model aims to address both of these limitations, as we are trying to use an end-to-end deep learning method to exploit the complementarity between the two connectomes and learn representations that are directly predictive of phenotypic information. As we mentioned earlier, a natural way to look at brain connectivity is by considering the graph structure between these communicating regions, where each node could have a multidimensional signal that's associated with it. Recently, graph convolutional networks have become a popular tool for this flavor of analysis. A typical GCN layer consists of multiple filters that aggregates connectivity information within nodes of the graph. So composed together, the layers can underscore pathways of information propagation as guided by a downstream task such as case control prediction. There are several works which use graph convolutional networks to predict diagnosis from brain connectivity, for example, from resting state fMRI or DTI. So these methods consider only one modality at a time. On the other hand, even GCNs that look at multimodal connectomes typically fix the graph structure based on DTI and vectorize the information from functional connectivity. Effectively, this does not take into account the geometry of the graph structure, particularly within the functional connectivity itself. Finally, all of these methods exclusively focus on case control discrimination and do not examine more fine-grained phenotypic characterizations. We will now introduce the MGCN model which we propose. Our model consists of mainly two parts. The first is a representation learning module, which uses a graph convolutional feature extractor, as shown in green. The second is a regression model that maps to phenotypic measures. Let us look at the model in the green box first. From the resting state data, we have connectivity information represented as a correlation matrix of size P cross P. Complementary to this, we have tryptography based on structural connectivity matrices from DTI data, and this informs us of anatomical connectivity within the same brain ROIs. Our model assumes that the latent graph structure for a patient is given by the DTI graph Laplacian L with the correlation matrix gamma n being the associated graph signal. First, we learn a hidden representation, which is calculated by a topological graph filtering operation at each node pair within the graph. Mathematically, if WR and WC are the row and column filters, this filtering operation can be represented by this equation which combines the row and column filtering terms. At a high level, this computes a weighted sum of the functional connectivity profile as regularized by the DTI graph Laplacian. Said another way, this is similar to the first order approximation to graph filtering from Kipf and Welling's 2017 paper, and the structure of this convolution is similar to the E2E filters from Kawahara et al. Next, we use a second graph convolutional operation with pooling to map to a node-wise representation H2, which is mathematically summarized within this node-based filtering equation. This is similar to the flavor of centrality measures in graph theory, as it effectively summarizes node-wise information. Lastly, we perform a third graph convolutional embedding using fully connected layers with weights G, and this is what we use as input to the regression model that we develop. So a regression model is a simple three-layered, multi-layered perceptron with fully connected layers and leaky ReLU activation. The output y hat n can be either a single or a multi-output measure of phenotypic information. This is our overall architecture, which we train using a combination of L1 and L2 losses. Empirically, we found that this gives a good trade-off between stability and generalization over different regimes in the loss landscape. Our model parameters were set using a separate validation set of 30 patients from the Human Connectome Project database. Moving on, we will now look at our evaluation and results. So we have two separate data sets with both resting state and DTI scans for different subjects that we evaluate on. So the first is a set of 275 healthy controls from the Human Connectome Database, or the HCP. Our second data set is an in-house data set with patients diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder from the Kennedy Krieger Hospital. This is our KKI data set. On the behavioral side, our evaluation on the HCP particularly is a single score prediction task to map to the CFIS, or the Cognitive Fluid Intelligence score. On the other hand, for our in-house dataset, we have a separate multi-score prediction task where we have three separate measures of clinical severity quantifying different impairments that are associated with autism. The first is ADOS, which is a clinician's report on communicative, social deficits, and restricted repetitive behaviors. SRS is a patient-teacher report which measures impaired social awareness, while finally, Praxis is a motor behavioral exam that is administered by a clinician. As such, it is known that ASD is a pretty heterogeneous disorder, and this makes it particularly challenging to develop tools which capture these wide range of impairments simultaneously and reliably from limited data. Our evaluation strategy is a five-fold cross-validation on both our model and the baselines. So we have five separate classes of baselines that we compare against. The first is a multimodal ANN with the correlation features and the structural Laplacian features as inputs. The information between the two is fused by a Hadamard product. We designed this neural network to have the same number of learnable parameters as the MGCN, and this helps evaluate the benefit provided by using the GCN as a feature extractor. Our second baseline uses the same architecture as the MGCN, but we now remove the contributions from the DTI graph Laplacians. This helps us evaluate the benefit of adding structural regularization to guide the representation learning. And both of these baselines may be considered as ablated versions of our model. The third is an adaptation of the BrainNet CNN, where we have two branches, one for the which takes in as input the resting state static connectomes, while the second takes in as input the DTI connectomes. We combine these representations to map to behavior. Our fourth baseline is a recent work from Mikai 2019 to predict clinical severity from resting state fMRI. The model combines a dictionary learning generative term with a neural network predictor, where both blocks are optimized in an end-to-end fashion. Our final comparison is similar in flavor to the joint optimization strategy, but operates on dynamic RSFMRI correlation matrices and incorporates the DTI regularization into the dictionary learning. Overall, these last two baselines evaluate the benefit of the GCN for the implicit representation learning over a classical decomposition strategy. Now, let's look at the results, first for HCP, for the prediction of the cognitive score. So, we have three main evaluation metrics: the median absolute error, the normalized mutual information, and the correlation coefficient. Higher correlation coefficient than NMI and lower MAE indicate improved performance. In this sense, we observe that on the test samples, our framework outperforms all of the baselines in terms of all three measures. On the KKI dataset, recall that we were examining the ability of each method to jointly predict all three measures, namely ADOS, SRS, and Praxis. We observe that our framework clearly outperforms the ANN, the RSFMRI-only GCN, and the BrainNet CNN on the multi-score prediction task. As for the last two baselines, we observe that our framework provides improved performance on SRS and Praxis, but ties for best performance with that of the dictionary learning plus ANN model for ADOS. As such, generalizing to predicting multiple clinical measures is inherently challenging due to the variability along with the heterogeneity in the dataset. This is indicated by the performance trends that we observe by comparing single versus multi-score regression from the first, previous, and current slide. Thus, our framework is an important first step to developing end-to-end models which generalize reliably on small data sets. As a qualitative comparison, we examine average row and column filter weights learned by our framework in the first layer channels by plotting them as a heat map. These filters are first matched according to their similarity, and then we plot the most frequently occurring filters for the MGCN and the RSFMRI-only GCN. Upon comparing example set of filters, we observe that the MGCN provides slightly more selectivity in terms of the patterns, as can be seen by the spread of the filter weights, which gives rise to comparably sparser patterns on the left plots than the right plots. So before concluding, we would like to examine our funding sources, acknowledge our funding agencies, and to finally summarize our contributions, we have proposed a novel multimodal GCN to fuse together structural and functional connectivity data. Our structural graphs act as regularizers on the optimization, which in turn boosts performance and gives rise to selectivity in the learned patterns. Finally, our framework learns to effectively generalize on two data sets of modest sizes, which is a challenging paradigm both in the clinical neuroimaging as well as deep learning space. Thank you for listening to me, and if you have any questions, feel free to reach out. Specifically, we have designed a graph neural network to combine